I hate to tell you this, but you need to watch this video if you put anything on your lashes. Today I'm talking about, do lash serums age your eye, thin the skin, get rid of the fat, change the color, and even irritate and give you red eye, the very thing you don't want when you're trying to make your eye in your periorbital region look better. The one thing giving you amazingly longer, thicker, darker eyelashes is also causing your eyes to age prematurely. Those luxuriant lashes are distracting you from noticing a worrisome and sinister loss of volume in your upper eyelid folds, thinning of your eyelid skin, and causing discoloration in the lids and even permanently changing the iris color. The iris is the colored part of the eye inside of the white of the eye. These changes can be seen after as little as 3 months, and some have even said 1.5 months of using lash grow products that contain prostaglandin analogs, and I'm going to talk about which ones you need to worry about. And it's not just the prescription ones that contain it. Let's talk. Now the good news is this can be avoided, of course. I wouldn't give you a video like this if there wasn't a solution. What would I do and tell my patients? I'm gonna go through exactly that. Below the video where it says more info, you can click to see the products that I use and particularly the lash product, because there are some that don't contain this ingredient. But even if you choose to use them, I'll give you some tips on how to use them. We're always balancing risk versus reward. Everything we do, just about everything in life, but certainly in aesthetics, carries a risk. You're trying to mitigate risk and balance risk for reward. People love their lashes, but the products I use do not contain this ingredient. Let's cruise in. You've never likely heard of this before, right? You're not alone. I talk to people all the time at conferences and my patients where I'm noticing I'm just not getting ahead on their eye rejuvenation, and they're shocked to hear this information, even though it's in the package inserts. The information is right there before your eyes. It's always in small print, it seems, but it's there. Allergan's blockbuster lash growth product, Latisse. The FDA requires them to disclose this information in the package insert and even state this in the fine print in their ads, like their TV ads. But how many people actually read the fine print? And there's so much there, even on TV commercials. It takes up now 3/4 of the commercial. No one pays attention. It's almost a waste of time. Your prescribing doctor probably has never even seen the packaging insert, certainly maybe not read it. We just fire them in the garbage. Perhaps you never even talked to a doctor about Latisse. If you purchase your lash growth product online or even in the clinic, how many people have time to go through all those side effects? So it's common, people don't know about it, nor do the companies want you to. It's why you're here, it's why you're on this channel, but it's why I struggle sometimes, even with platelet-rich fiber and fillers and devices, to get the eye area looking great so I see it firsthand. And how important is the eye to beauty? Extremely. Not only is it the window to the soul, but beautiful eyes framed by great brows and lashes and a white colored part of the eye is gorgeous. The Allergan Latisse studies exclusively use pictures of closed eyelids. Have a look at them. That's how they measured the lash growth. When these first came out, we found it odd to see eyes kind of closed with the lashes down, but we thought, okay, well maybe that's why we could actually see the lashes and there was a reason to it. But we don't use before and afters in medicine with the eyes closed and looking down like this. So it was unusual, but we accepted it. Now we know why. These pictures don't record the loss of upper eyelid volume due to the fat atrophy, or the atrophy means shrinkage of the fat. And remember, that's the exact thing we're trying to plump when we do platelet-rich fibrin. And of course, fillers, you're trying to add volume. Well, those kind of pictures on that angle, you can't see the fat loss. You have to look directly on, like you're looking at me, and it's all around the eye. Looking down like that, you just don't see it. They also used a very insensitive assessment of the iris color, or the colored part of the eye. That choice meant they had very little to observe about the orbital atrophy or the iris color change. Thus, these issues are rarely talked about by doctors and patients. Here's what we do know about the prostaglandin lash growth and the generic bimatoprost solution that's used to treat glaucoma or high pressure in the eye. Early studies in the new category of glaucoma medication showed that they powerfully reduced the intraocular pressure, which is great, but they also had some curious side effects. One of these was that exposure to these compounds for as little as 2 to 15 days, very short period of time, induced dramatic growth of both eyelashes and underdeveloped hairs that are found around the eye or lanugo. So it affected fine hair and, of course, the lashes. If you're treating glaucoma, this is a side effect you may not want. But if you're a drug company, you're looking for new markets, this side effect looks like a new treatment to help patients with sparse eyelash hairs, and the beauty industry is huge and they knew it. These observations became the whole basis for Latisse, which was approved in 2008. And a quick story to interject here, because we're going to talk about that it's in Latisse, but it's also in many other things. Now, how do I know? 2008, Latisse came in, we were selling it, it was flying off the shelves. Around 2010, other companies came in, I can think of four off the top of my head. They said, hey, you know what? We're as good or better than Latisse without the eye irritation, because the prostaglandins cause eye irritation in as much as 50% of people. We're like, wow. How is this working? No one really questioned it. Come down to 2011-12, come to find out, there was what I would call illegal drug within the conditioner. They would say, well, it's the last conditioner, it has biotin, it has botanicals in there, but come to find out, it actually did have the active drug, which is a prostaglandin agonist. So it's kind of like cheating. So the same side effect profile would have been there. But this wasn't known that well back then. Now it's known, and that's what I'm telling you about today. So as I'm going through it, don't just think about Latisse. We're singling it out because it's FDA approved and studied. So many of these aren't FDA regulated. And you would think, well, how do they have the drug in it? But they do, whether it's listed or not. If it works, it likely has it in there. Let's move on. The lash growth was not the only side effect that was observed from the glaucoma. So we got hair growth, but the lash growth was there. That's great. Every drug, as you know, has side effects we need to know about. The investigators studying this new class of lash growth products found some other things. Eyelid and conjunctival redness and irritation are probably the most commonly and widely observed side effects. 50 to 60% of people have these. It's very high. In carefully performed studies comparing pre-treatment and post-treatment iris color images, increased pigment is seen in up to, get this, 70% of the eyes. That's huge. The change in the iris color is thought to be permanent, but in most cases the change, it is subtle, but permanent. People don't want their eye color change, especially if they like it, and if it's sparkle or sprinkled through it, sometimes that's even worse. Initially, I recall it being touted as 2 to 3%, but likely that was due to the insensitive imaging of the studies. That's retrospectively what we're looking at now. Why didn't we catch it earlier? We weren't given the data, the raw data. In 2004, two optometrists, Poplinski and Smith, they published a paper, which you can read, reporting on three of their patients who were using bimatoprost for the glaucoma, which is same as Latisse, and who developed deepening of the upper eyelid sulcus. And this is really what I'm most concerned about. I was going to say perplexed. I'm actually not perplexed now that I see it. In retrospect, I was, but now it makes total sense. But this is what I want you to know about, so pay attention here. These individuals were only using the drop in one eye. So if you have high pressure in one eye, you don't need the drop in the other eye. So you have like a study, a control. The control is the eye that never got the drop and the one that did. Why would one age differently than the other? So it highlighted the contrast caused by the loss of volume in the upper eyelid fold, in that one eye. In one case, the effect was seen after just 6 weeks of treatment. So that's not long. The authors called this prostaglandin-associated periorbitopathy. Orbit meaning the eye, and opathy meaning disease. While this was the first report, you know what happens, numerous authors have now come forward and documented and further described this entity. Why? Because now we're attuned to it, we look for it. So this loss of volume in the upper orbit is seen with all of the prostaglandin glaucoma drops, but the effect is greatest for the bimatoprost. The medication is in Latisse, and the study suggested 50 to 60% of individuals, that's 50 to 60% using this type of drop will develop deepening of the upper eyelid sulcus. That's huge. That's astronomical for a percentage. I gotta tell you, that's half the people. And that's the ones you can see it in, so maybe others have it, but you can't see it with the naked eye, and it does happen. Studies suggest that stopping the treatment, this is important to look at, stopping the treatment reverses the effects in some, but not in all the cases. This may be related to how long the eyelid, the tissues around it, because when you put a drop in the eye, they don't just go on the eye, they go around the tissues behind and around the eye. The drop, and of course, you know, it's a mucous membrane, so there's a lot of exposure to the drug because there's a lot of absorption. So the longer you use it, maybe the worse it is. Loss of volume isn't the only change that is reported. And I should say that it's thought to be in many irreversible, as is the color. So maybe partially reversible, but when you have fat around the eye, you want all of it. So the loss of volume wasn't the only thing that was reported. Investigators also noted patients referred for assessment for this periorbitopathy, they found that almost all of the patients referred to them had thinning of the upper eyelid and other changes consistent with fibrosis of the upper eyelid. So what am I trying to do all the time? Thicken the dermis, get the skin better. They showed thinning of the skin. Discontinuation of the treatment only resulted in partial resolution of this dermal thinning. This, of course, what was found for individuals using the bimatoprost for glaucoma, but we can extrapolate it. The average age for people being treated for glaucoma is about 70. That's the average. Do they look older as a result of using these drops? Absolutely. But the trade-off is that they can see. So they're not really complaining, and older people rarely at the age of 70 plus are coming in worried about aesthetics. They're happy to see, be functioning. So it may well be underreported. They care less about the aesthetics and more about seeing. So we really need to look into this further. If someone is 20 or 30 and using it for lashes, this spells what? Disaster. Different than if you're 70 and using it. I have plenty of patients in their 70s and 80s that care about aesthetics, but so many don't. That's why it was missed originally. And remember, as we get older, 60, 70, 80 plus, the fat pads in the eye to remove them, which is what you might have with a blepharoplasty or surgery to remove them, can be a good thing. So for the older population, they may have saw it as a positive, whereas for the younger generation, the hollow or the sinking of the eye is notably bad because the rest of the fat pads are robust. So that's the distinction with the age. There is some benefit here that could be a positive side effect for the older population. So what do you want to do if you want to avoid this whole mess altogether? What do I tell my patients to do? In a moment, I'm going to give you the list. That's an online list of products that have these prostaglandin analogs. But before that, what do? I use, for my patients, I advise them to use growth factors. And Antiage has a what's called the overnight lash serum, and this is what it looks like. Despite a small vial, it actually has a couple months supply in here. When you get larger looking vials, like some people have ones that look like this, I have these lash serums all over my practice from the years of using it. This is RevitaBrow actually, but when you get the larger ones, often there's as much in the smaller ones, and these are much more portable. So don't let the container size fool you. Look at the volume. I don't have it exactly here. I think this is about 3.5 mLs and this is 3, so you can get fooled. But the growth factors do not have prostaglandin analogs in them. It's two totally different ways that this works. There are products that do not have even growth factors and just have botanical factors. I just don't think they work as well. If we look at a product like this, hair growth factors, there's 12 hair growth factors, and it keeps the hair in the anagen phase. Now, unfortunately, I know way too much about hair growth because 20 years ago, laser hair removal was way more popular than Botox or fillers. So all my clinics had a lot of hair removal going on. The anagen phase is the hair growth phase, and this has the growth factors to hold them in the growth phase, and the hair on the lids has much different growth phase durations than the hair on the body or the head. So the lashes are very specific, but it stimulates the epithelial cell proliferation, as it notes, differentiation and migration, and promotes the number of cell protective mechanisms that are inherent. So just like growth factors helping with your skin, those signal the body to hold it in that growth phase, which is what the prostaglandins do. They just have all the side effects. What's in here? I'll do a complete video on it if you like it. Again, in the more info section, you can look. I'll link the product if you'd like to. It also has hyaluronic acid, and we know hyaluronic acid has many benefits. There's also carnitine, biotin, which you hear a lot for hair, and then there's vitamin E. So it's a lash conditioner plus all of the growth factors that help hold that hair in the growth phase. Now, if you choose and you want to use one with the prostaglandin analogs, or maybe you're getting a positive side effect of loss of fat pads for some people, although remember, it also causes the fibrosis, the redness, the irritation that a product like this doesn't have, then you at least want to reduce the amount that gets into the eye. Remember, it only needs to get on the lash line. It doesn't have to get into the eye, nor do you want it to get into the eye, because that's when it spreads to the fat pad. But in general, for me, I don't want people to be using, my patients to be using prostaglandin analogs for the reasons we talked about. And growth factors may have other benefits, of course, as well. We will see. Next thing is, I have a list here of products which have that synthetic prostaglandin analog in it. Not saying they're bad or good products, do what you want to do, but buyer beware. And stay tuned, because there are other things you can do. But Xlash Eyelash Enhancer, Neulash, NeuveauBrow, RevitaLash, of course. I've used that. I've had that in my clinic for over 10 years. I haven't used it myself, but I've had it in the practice. Nutraluxe MD Lash, M2 Lashes, Peter Thomas Roth Lashes, Rodan and Fields Lash Boost. Those all have it in there. There's in there, I'm sure there's more. This isn't a complete list. But thinning of the skin around the eyes, redness of the eyes, loss of the orbital fat pad, and ophthalmos, where the eye moves in, and the eye irritation, those are some pretty steep prices to pay for longer lashes. I did do also a video on redness of the eyes from makeup, from lash extensions, from tattooing. Watch that video, because the eyes are important to aesthetics, so we spend time thinking about it, the periorbital region. I want to know from you, do you need more information from me? Put in the comments below what you want to see. I put a complete playlist up here of skincare tips for you, and another one below for things you can do at home to keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.